Hey, y'all. Hello, gentlemen in the back recording.
How are you?
I will try to be a little less. No, I won't. I got a call from my dear friend, the mother of my godson, James, who told me that she was doing the Black Women's Conference this year, and she invited me to come and be a part of it. And I said, yes. I said yes because there's something happening that you already know about because you've been here for a day and a half or 2 days and you've heard from other people. And I just want to say my piece about Say Her Name. I want to talk about Black girl geniuses and I want to talk about Black girls, but I mostly want to talk about Ruth Nicole Brown, and I'm gonna talk about her for the rest of my time, because I talk about her all over the country. I take her name everywhere I go, and you also need to know that I have people say, give us a name for an award. Give us a name for something that's going on, that somebody's doing something original that has never been done before. And I always give Ruth Nicole's name. And to this day, and this has been years, Ruth Nicole and I met in 2009. No one has actualized those awards yet. And that's not because of the work Ruth Nicole is doing or not doing. It is because I believe it is still the subject of Black girls. And nobody cares enough yet about what is happening to Black girls to then honor the mother of it all, for me. So instead of me talking to audiences where she is not positioned, I decided I didn't want to read my poetry. I want to talk directly about her to her face, because that's important for me to do. I'm going to do that in just a second, because I'm going to read an essay that means more to me than any essay I have ever written in my life. And I got gray hair and have had gray hair for a little while. But I wrote this essay, and I don't even remember writing it. It was out of body. And you can find the essay in the book, but you can't read it like I'm going to read it to you. So that's what I have come to do. And I decided that when I heard that Ruth Nicole was going to be here, because far too often we do our work separate from each other and we come together sometimes, but I want her to hear it from me, and I want you to hear what I feel about her, because I'm going to keep saying this until somebody listens to me in a big way. Not that your way is not a big way, but you know what I'm talking about. But before we do that, in Louisville, right down the road, in 2 weeks, Ruth Nicole and I will be coming together again to talk about Black girls in Louisville, bringing them together under the awning of art and poetry and music. And the folks that I'm working with in Louisville asked me, who should we bring with you? And I said, Ruth Nicole. Because you need to bring Ruth Nicole before you bring me. So we're going to be meeting there in 2 weeks. But when I did that with the organization in Louisville, they also introduced me to an amazing young poet who represents so much of what we're going to be doing there and what we're going to be doing across the country in a Black girl genius camp. Wait, let me say that. Y'all didn't hear what I said. I don't think y'all, there wasn't enough response to what I said. We are beginning Black Girl Genius Camp in Louisville that... that we hope will spread across the country like a good river. Hannah Drake is from Louisville. She will be working with us in teaching us about Louisville, teaching us about who is there and what and the work that has been going on there long before we get there. But I thought, what a wonderful thing if Hannah could come today, introduce herself to Lexington, and introduce herself to the Black Women's Conference. You could hear her brilliant, wonderful, amazing work. And not only is she here, but she brought her beautiful, amazing daughter with her who attends UK, Brianna, who's sitting right there. Wave your hand, Brianna. And so Hannah Drake is going to open this up, and then I'm going to come and talk about Ruth Nicole Brown. Hannah.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Nikki and Ruth. Hi, how are you? It's like I'm now I get to see your face, and that's wonderful. I'm just really honored to be here and share what I do. And when Nikki said it was in Lexington, I thought that's even better because I get to see my daughter. And some of the stories my daughter has told me did not shock me or surprise me, but saddened me. And this is the reason that I write, is the reason why I believe I was put on this earth. So thank you so much for allowing me to share. The first poem I will read is called 10 and 2, and I wrote it for my daughter. When my daughter turned 17, I decided it was time we had the talk. Only this was a little bit deeper than the birds and the bees. How do you sit your child down and tell them that their reality is not everyone's reality? That at times in this world, their ice will seem like it's colder than her ice. She walked into the house, eyes bright and smiling. 17, just a few months shy of leaving my home. 17, and she was almost grown, yet I felt the need to explain to her. She skipped into the house, flashing her driver's permit, just how deep this rabbit hole goes. Only she was not Alice, and this was not Wonderland. You see, this was not some psychedelic dream. While most parents can celebrate their child receiving their driver's permits and send them to the store on a trip for non-essential items like milk and bread, I had to remind my daughter that her going to the store could lead to her with a bullet in her head. I had to remind my daughter that holding her hands up in the act of surrendering could be her death sentence, that going to the store for Skittles and tea could be costly. While other high school friends celebrated their driver's permits, I had to explain to my daughter that driving while Black could be criminalistic, that walking while Black could be deadly, that breathing while Black some have found to be lethal, that running while Black could be costly, that wearing a hoodie could have life or death consequences, that being Black in this world meant being smart, staying on guard. I set my child down and I said, when, not if, but when the police pull you over, this is what you do. You keep your hands on the wheel at 10 and 2, and whatever you do, do not make any sudden moves. You see, this is not law and order. The police do not shoot to wound, they are shooting to kill you. When they come to your window, be polite. It was almost like I was giving my daughter this mandate to shuck and jive, but you see, in this world, I'm trying to save her life. Say yes, sir, and no, sir, and whatever you do, do not resist. If you give them any reason to kill you, this will be their defense, and you see, you being Black will be your only offense. Contrary to popular belief, for you, Officer Friendly does not exist. They will simply kill you not for who you are, but for what you represent. Do not offer any hesitation. Be prepared when they ask for your license and your registration. And even though I know you are innocent and under no obligation, I do not want to see your face on a t-shirt. I do not want your life picked apart by Facebook and Instagram pics. I do not want the person that you are reduced to a life of what could have been. I do not want your story to be just a quick soundbite on CNN.
I do not want to be one of those mothers weeping in agony as her child blood runs down the drain. And in less than 6 months, 6 weeks, 6 days, it'll be just another name. And you will be a memory hidden underneath preachers looking for 15 minutes of fame, phony indictments, corruption, and a justice system that has turned a blind eye to righteousness. So this is my message to you, baby. This is the talk. And I know that this is difficult. Every day we swallow down the bitterness of this reality until we feel like we can choke. And when it's time for the revolution, believe me, you and I will be the first ones to revolt. But right now you're just a teenage girl that wants to drive. And right now I'm just a mother that wants to save your life. 10 and 2.
Thank you. Thank you. This next poem I wrote, it's like a poem that changed my life. It's like a minute and 45 seconds, literally. And I wrote it after Beyonce did the Super Bowl. Now, whether you like Beyonce or not, it's not relevant. But what mattered to me was Monday came, and it was like everybody forgot Beyonce was black. But I didn't, because she's been black. She's black. So, so I wrote this poem, and... In a matter of days, it went viral instantly, which has really been a blessing, but I think it just resonated with a lot of people, and it's called Formation. Formation. Said firmly with no hesitation. Concern for your tears recently went on vacation. We are unbothered by your hating and your condemnation. It is simply confirmation and the very reason we're celebrating. This is the manifestation of a bloodline that birthed a nation. We ain't offspring, we're the foundation of creation. When you sip from Mother Earth, you're drinking our libations. This is lyrical liberation. You want to be mad at something? Be mad at the blood on the hands of this nation. This is the reincarnation of a spirit that has no expiration. This is old Negro spiritual salvation. That down south church fan waving congregation. This is B's black fist standing on Rock Nation. But since you seem to need some clarification... This is for 40 acres and a mule reparations, for picking cotton in fields with no compensation, for not telling slaves about emancipation, for Rosa being told to get in the back of your transportation, for Sarah Bartman's humiliation at the hands of your exploitation. This is for co-opting a cultural weak imitations, for Martin and Malcolm's assassinations, for countless years of segregation, for every time you told our brothers and sisters to assume the formation, for keeping them locked in a system chained to probation, for a racist system masquerading as fair administration. This is for Sandra Bland dead on the floor of a police station for smallpox infestation. This is for Tuskegee experimentation, for telling us why all lives matter with no qualifications. This is for brutally raping a nation, for Eric Garner's suffocation. This is for a black male shot dead at Fruitville Station. And this voice is the reincarnation of everyone you murdered with no justification. Now you bow down and simply assume the formation. Thank you. Thank you. And the last poem I will do is called Power. Of course, it's for women empowerment. Power. The capacity or ability to influence the behavior of others or the course of events. Power. Physical might. Power. The energy or motive force by which a physical system or machine it's operated. Power, that thing that is in you, rumbling deep in your gut, flowing through your veins, making your heart beat, that feminine instinct that allows an ordinary woman to do extraordinary things, that allows a high school dropout to go back to school, that allows a woman beat down to leave an abusive relationship, that gives a woman the courage to say, I love you, but I love me a little bit more. That thing that says, not tomorrow, not when I turn 40, not when I retire, not when it's a new year, but today. Today is the day that I will muster up the power within me to take back everything that was stolen from me, to fulfill my dreams, to leave a job that doesn't pay me what I'm worth, to look cancer in the face and say, give me your best shot. Today is the
the day that I declare that diabetes doesn't have to be generational, that the curse of molestation ceases with me, that I will stop living paycheck to paycheck, that I will become a role model for my children, that I recognize that if I'm good enough to sleep with, then I'm good enough to marry. Today is the day that the pity party comes to an end. The time for excuses is over. Today is the day that I declare that I will no longer live defeated. I will not dim my light in order for you to feel brighter, baby. I was born to shine. I am more than a conqueror. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm a righteous woman that falls down 7 times but gets up 8. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I am a woman with unlimited possibilities and infinite potential. I possess the power to make daydreams reality, to make my life one that matters. And today is the day that I step into my destiny. I can be whatever I say I can be, and I am whoever I say I am. And today I say that I am strong, wise, beautiful, intelligent, revolutionary, authentic, destined for greatness. I am a woman. I'm a woman that loves hard and strong. I'm a woman that loves pink frilly things. I'm a woman that revels in being a woman, being treated like a lady, but never attempt to paint me into a corner, because baby was never meant to be put in a corner. My life cannot be defined by coloring in lines. I am 360 degrees of pure femininity, bolstered by his promises to me. And today is the day that we access our power. And by doing that, we give another woman the ability to grasp hers, to shine, to grow, to illuminate all that God has placed inside of her. Someone right now, right at this very moment, is waiting on you to be all that you can be so that they can be all that they are destined to be. We are the key to someone's lock. We are strength personified. We are the epitome of power. We are women. And together we possess the ability to change communities, to change policies, to change lives, and to finally exhale deeply and just breathe with ease. Today is the day that we access our power. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, 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 yes. Okay, now we begin after we have already begun with that. I want to say two or three things before I read this essay. One of the reasons Ruth Nicole and I are going to Louisville is because when we were told about the group in Louisville, he said, you know, one of the things that's happening is the young men come to the center after school and hang out and participate. And he said, but the young girls don't. He said, but there is one young girl who comes and she doesn't want to leave because she doesn't want to go home. And so there's no place for her to go. And so she comes and she stays at the center, but then she doesn't, when it's time to close the door, she doesn't have any place to go. That's one story. The other story is, if you could think about when in the last month or two you have heard something happening to a black girl, just put that in your mind. What has it been? I'll tell you a couple of things that I'm thinking of. UN peacekeepers. Did you hear that story? UN peacekeepers raped young black girls in Africa. They came forward and told this story. Not only that, if that's not horrific enough, some of the UN peacekeepers tied up the young black girls and made them have sex with dogs. This is headline. This was a month ago. One of the young girls who was made to have sex with the dog died of some unknown disease. That's two stories. Three stories. South Carolina, black girl sitting at her desk, looking at her cell phone, because nobody knows why, but it's early morning, the teacher asked her to put it away, she doesn't put it away. You know this story, the security officer is called, right? She's still looking at her cell phone. Her classmate takes a picture of the security officer dumping her out of that chair like a sack of potatoes, then picking her up and throwing her against the wall because she's still holding onto her cell phone. She is arrested in front of her classmates, taken out of that classroom. So is her friend who is sticking up for her. Nobody figures out in that moment that her mother has just died. Nobody asked her that. She is fearing going to foster care. Nobody asked her that. Why? Because she's a black girl. And you don't talk to black girls. You just empty them out of their chairs and then deal with them in a violent way. These aren't isolated stories. And in this moment we are in, there are things happening. Books are coming out now about pushback on black girls being victimized and in school systems, and you know, whether they're heterosexual or queer or transgender. Books are coming out, they're getting NPR headline news, and I'm so grateful for that. But I'm not here to talk about that problem that those kinds of texts are illuminating. I'm here to talk about Ruth Nicole Brown, who is not coming at the question from that direction. She's coming at it from another way. Not to say, not to put the light on that, but to put the light on who black girls are. Not to say, come on, black girl, be a different kind of black girl. But to say, come on, black girl, we see you as you are. It is something that is so powerful that when I first saw it, when I went to Black Girl Genius Week, I was transformed. I did not know, I knew she was doing something incredible, but I did not know how incredible it was until we went to the school system after school, and we must have been surrounded by 200 black girls who waited on us to come and be with them. Why? Because they got to dance together. Because they got to make art together. Because somebody in the world could see them and not say, why you got that on? Why you walking that way? What's wrong with the way you talking? There was no fear in the room. None. It was revolutionary. It can be revolutionary if we are not afraid of black girls. I'm going to read this because it's so important to me, and I hope we have a little time at the end to talk about it. Pinky Swear. Y'all know what Pinky Swear is? Y'all don't know what Pinky Swear is. Soul Hot and Dr. Ruth Nicole Brown, Pioneer. Two epigraphs. The spirit will not descend without a song. Leroy Jones. Second epigraph, the concept of Soul Hot was born out of disturbing research that reported that girls, particularly adolescents, were at risk and suffering from societal pressures instrumental in the development of low self-esteem, loss of voice, and self-inflicted harmful behaviors. Dr. Ruth Nicole Brown. First, a lot of little sections. This is called first person plural. 369, the goose drank wine, the monkey chewed tobacco on the streetcar line, the line broke, the monkey got choked, they all went to heaven in a little rowboat, clap, clap. This introduction is personal. Soul Hot is my reminder that there were black girl songs that I grew up singing in South Carolina. Soul Hot reminds me that not much happened in my little black girl life or my big black girl life that was not graced by song and dance. I have been away from this critical memory for too long. Every alphabet of this introduction holds my DNA. And I'm talking about black girlhood celebration. Ruth Nicole Brown's text for us, if we would but listen. There are many tribes that intersect my black woman American life, but the research that helped Dr. Ruth Nicole forge the birth canal for Soul Hot the organization that she founded, concerns members of my most intimate tribe, Black girls. I have not always liked being a girl, but I have never wanted to be anything but a Black girl. The not liking had more to do with how I was treated, not how I got along with myself. When the world finally backed up and gave me room to do what I came here to do, I make a living by teaching in the academy, but I make a life by living, writing, feeling, thinking, and dreaming in the present and historical air of the communities that raised me as a Black girl child, then set me loose, capable, and prepared out in the world. I am here to introduce the field notes, y'all, and findings of a fierce young pioneering artist and scholar, Ruth Nicole Brown. Dr. Ruth Nicole has set herself and those who believe as she believes out on a journey to discover and explore what it means to be a Black girl growing up beneath these disturbing contemporary findings. What does it mean to be a Black girl in America 200 years after the legal abolition, it took so much longer, of the African to America slave trade? What does it mean to be a Black girl growing up on the eve of the first Black Democratic nominee for president of the United States? What does it mean to be a Black girl in a world where the dominant sounds and images of Black girls in the public sphere, regardless of anybody's run for the president, remain those Black girls who are loud and accustomed to being abandoned on rooftops? Black girls who are relegated to the background of life, pancake boxes included. Black girls in trouble, Black girls to fear or change or enlist in rigid and regular discipline, and thus ultimately to save. Let us please save the Black girls. What does it mean for a bright-eyed Black woman scholar right here not to focus on someone else's community, but to focus on and value her own, turning it into her life's work? For such a scholar to make the time for the questions and to search for the critical crucibles that shape the lives of these Black girls means that there is a Black woman scholar in this world who is as devoted to the freedom and uplift of Black girls now as Harriet Tubman was to the freedom and uplift of the whole enslaved lot of us. Soul Hot's fearless leader and the author of Black Girlhood Celebration, Dr. Ruth, is artist, scholar, playwright, researcher, good listener, mother, hip-hop devotee, defines and uses hip-hop culture and feminist methodology as the way in. She does this to transform oppressive institutions, policies, relationships, and beliefs in young women. This is groundbreaking, y'all. No, this is old hallowed ground breaking open. It's not for the faint of heart. It's not for the weak of spirit. It's not for those who like to go along with the program. If that's what you want, that's not what this is about. It's not for those who prefer to control everything. It's not for the uncourageous. When you look and listen to these girls, when you see them, when you put your eye on them, these girls giving testimony as they graduate from the program, as they move on out into the world, you quickly realize that their time together has truly made something tangible, lifelong, something that makes me want to extend my pinky finger to each and every one of them just to be sure that the deal they have uncovered and discovered waiting deep inside their joyous genius heart is now sealed. Pinky swear. 100 times. I have been asked at least 100 times to travel and talk to young girls all across the country about the path of my own life. Come, they would say, tell the young girls what you did. Come, let them see how you became who you became. I have been honored to do so, but I have never been asked to travel and listen to any young girls talk about how they see the world or how they think the world sees them. I'm the student. They're the teacher. Always while out in the middle of whatever I have come to say, even if I look up and reach out in hopes of lifting up a two-way conversation into the air, most of the girls still look lost. No matter what I say to them, they still look lost. What could I possibly want to hear from them? I want to hear everything. I'll admit I didn't push hard enough sometimes, and that's what Soul Hot has made me rethink. This foundational model of Black girl powerlessness is the same model that Dr. Ruth Nicole experienced before inventing, let me say that word again, inventing Soul Hot. She and hundreds more of us, role models of success, that's what my mama would call it, experienced the moment in much the same way. Certainly, we don't all view the setup with the same eyes. Speaking only for myself, in each and every one of those, you too can be a success moments. Invitations was the absolute theory of black girl as empty vessel who needed me to make them into who they needed to be. You got to throw that out the window. That's not it. We're rethinking that, right? In every situation, the stage was set for me having the answers for the girls I was about to meet, who had been carefully instructed to keep mostly quiet and please be still when the lady is up front talking to you. This prefabricated stage remains the set design all across the country for far too many of us who are dealing and talking to young black girls. Black Girl Celebration made me want to change the set design. You gotta change it. If we are really serious about having the conversations we need to have, we gotta change the set design. This is called Free Black Girl Iambic Pentameter. Another Ruth Nicole quote. We do not have a language that accurately describes what it means to work with black girls in a way that is not controlling their bodies and or producing white middle-class girl subjectivities. Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying. Y'all too quiet. Soul Hot does not begin with the lie that black girls are some type of aberration of the norm. When you think something is an aberration of the norm, you pick them up out of their school seats and drop them on their head and then knock them against the wall. When you think somebody is an aberration, you tie them up on the ground and you make them have sex with a dog. It begins with a question that is as old as dirt, a biblical question, but not a theocratic one. Quote, ain't you got a right to the tree of life? Black Girlhood Celebration, the book, is the necessary primer for the birth of this call and its affirming response, yes. She would be embarrassed to hear me say it, but she's gonna hear me say it. I believe Dr. Ruth Nicole Brown is spiritual daughter to Harriet Tubman. Her big mind and her even bigger desire to lead this charge into a territory that demands both insights and answers is core, critical, resistance, and action. This is work and research that has not been done, has not been compiled in the 21st, 20th century. Black Girlhood Celebration speaks volumes about Dr. Ruth's deep concentration and connection to black love and that familial cycle that is wider than the self, wider than the self. Bam Bam Barara. 38 years ago, Red Book Magazine published an article by the black American writer Tony K. Bambara entitled, quote, The Children Who Get Cheated, end quote. In it, Bambara wrote, quote, the black community now is moving toward solutions to a problem, the miseducation of our children, that would have provoked bloody warfare in a lesser people. In several major cities throughout the country, the black community has become increasingly adamant in pushing for community control, for we regard the current system of remote control by non-neighborhood whites as a manipulative attempt to keep black parents invisible, mute, and powerless. But when you boil it all down, the essential ingredient, this is still Bambara, of education is two-way learning, mutual understanding, mutual respect, dialogue. So most teachers under present system are simply incompetent to teach our children. They are incompetent because they have too little knowledge of, too little appreciation for, and very little professional encouragement to learn about the black child, his worth, his possibilities, her possibilities. It would be asking too much, perhaps, to expect a white person conditioned by the social mores and myths of this country to have any attitude other than outright racist or paternalistic in dealing with a black person. When we were at the school, the girls were laughing so hard. They were giggling. You couldn't hear yourself for the sound they were making with each other. A teacher came out. Y'all remember this? And she said, y'all are making too much noise. It's after school, the bell has rung. we just with each other. We're dancing, we got music on. She said, you got to shut this down. I won't tell you what happened after that. We'll just keep with the essay. A classical people deserve a classical art. Lorraine Hansberry was born and raised in South Chicago, Illinois. Ruth Nicole Brown was born and raised in South Chicago, Chicago Heights, Illinois. Something must be in South Chicago water that teaches the power of art and fosters the art of a power. Hansberry believed that, quote, a classical people deserve a classical art, end quote. Dr. Ruth Brown, fellow playwright and believer in the power of art to guide and illuminate, believes black girl dance is classical in the African and African American tradition. That's why she puts the music on. Classical, by definition, relates to the most highly developed stage of an earlier civilization and its culture. Invisible black girl. All understanding is not always available to the tongue. I am a woman deeply connected to my body. I make decisions about jobs and sweethearts and whether I should walk down unfamiliar streets with information received from my belly, not my head. I believe I understood the power of the body even as an infant through my umbilical cord, that tiny floating arm, I call it, that my mother used to stay in touch with me all the way through the birth canal. This understanding of the body came to me through my poetic sensibilities. I have and keep a fierce responsibility to my body as well as to my mind. I hold on to this responsibility by way of words, language, and silence. I also understand the power of the physical, most especially through the heat, sweat, and heart-pounding pleasure of dance. Not, with all due respect, Arthur Mitchell's Dance Theater of Harlem, very nice. Not East St. Louis, Catherine Dunham, very nice, very nice. Or the precision choreography of the great Pearl Primus. No, I'm not talking about that. My dance and expertise was, I call it extra local. The sweet, sweat, and heart-pounding evenings came by way of Friday night high school dances in community centers in Sumter, South Carolina, or the very subversive blue light in the basement dances. All right. Oh, y'all see the hands coming up now. Okay. Thrown together in a flash at somebody's house in the neighborhood where we lived and grew and eventually left. Later, that remarkable sweet heat and sweat followed me all to the all-night Saturday night dances in the upper lounge of Talladega College, hosted by the Omegas, the Kappas, the Sigmas, Alphas, anybody. If they said there was a dance, the poet was at the door. See, y'all don't know that about me, because y'all don't play music when I come to your house. Dr. Ruth Nicole knows dance, too. She dances with her girls, their mamas, and the other teachers in the room. They just start the music. I was all trying to be all cute. I had my hands in my pocket. I was like, can I join you? I mean, I'm a professor. I'm a poet. I'm old. I got gray hair. Can I do this? You got to see it to believe the power that happens when you forget all that other people have put on you and you remember yourself and how your heart feels and your legs want to go and you don't stop them. At my first Black Girl Genius Week, I went up to the mic. I did some singing, what would you call it? Rapping, yeah, I was rapping. I mean, we had 5 minutes to write our lines, and then we had the mic just like this, and I was like, okay, I'm up. To her beat, and it's on tape. You can listen to it. I listen to it all the time. I say, who is that? I think a black woman who dances with herself is probably some kind of unspoken black girl tradition, no matter what part of the country we hail from. Those of us who love to dance cannot always wait for a partner to come and take our hand. The music is there, the drapes are closed or not. The one who loves to move must have her way with it. Dr. Ruth Nicole is not afraid of dance or its power, language, or meaning. Do you know that black dance is called the last bastion of African culture? That's the one thing that has not been bought and sold. You see some African dance, you don't have to ask where it came from or who's doing it or what's being talked about. It's pure, and last bastion of us. The music is there, the drapes are closed or not. The one who loves to move must have her way with it. Dr. Ruth Nicole is not afraid of dance or its power, language, or meaning. Turn some pages in Black Girlhood Celebration, and she will tell you herself that to dance is to be fierce and free in the body that brought one here to earth. With dance as her instruction manual, Dr. Ruth Nicole is teaching black girls to not be afraid of their bodies. Images of the soul hot girls and women dancing remind me so deeply of my old, old love for this black woman's sacred movement. But why did I have to be reminded? How did I ever let it go? I was the young girl poet known for writing poems beneath 100-year-old oaks by day and closing down dances in the upper lounge by night. When did I allow the gaze of the outside world to make me hyper-conscious of my love for dancing? I was the young woman poet who left the dances in the upper lounge of Talladega College drenched, spent, and smiling. I appreciated dance so much before I moved into the undancing academy. Let me say that again. I appreciated dance so much before I moved into the undancing academy. There are things whispered by well-dressed power brokers in some professional environments that should be considered a kind of murder. You can't dance like that out in public and be taken seriously in this life or receive tenure in this life. The moment I abandoned the dance floor, I also abandoned some core element of my black girl self. Pinky swear. Dancing is Soul Hot's way of saying, I am here. I will not compromise who I am. I love who I am. See me. This is my body that I am moving. I know I look good. I know I feel good. You can't make me feel bad about this body moving in this way. This is my black classical tradition. Step back. I'm about to represent. Dance is widely known as one of the forms of black expression that has unquestionably survived Afrophobia. In 1995, only a few months before her death, Toni K. Bambara, who had never ever used the word mentor in my presence or direction, but who had regularly invited many of us in the Atlanta community to sit together to talk openly about writing, sent me a postcard from her hospice bed. She had just received a copy of my second book of poetry, Rice. The one-line postcard read this: Nikki, do not leave the arena to the fools. Her passionate entreaty to me, write, black girl, write. Spin your words out onto the page until they enter the larger world circle. Don't let anyone think they can have their important conversations without you present and accounted for. The education of the storyteller. I'm almost finished, y'all. Well, not almost, but almost. In her last book of essays, Toni K. Bambara captures a precocious scene. This is a really important scene. I can't say that this loud enough. A precocious scene from her girlhood with her grandma, Dorothy. No blood relation, I'm telling you. But nevertheless, an older woman involved in her ultimate day-to-day raising. In the pages of the essay, little Toni has come home to announce, hands on hips, that she has been taught and proudly comprehends the much acclaimed Einstein's theory of relativity to Miss Dorothy. Toni K. Bambara, as little girl, sets out to be clear in her explanation to the older woman that the theory of relativity is not one of their usual daily subjects, not one of those call and response deals, Grandma Dorothy. Uh-huh, Grandma Dorothy says. Well, get on with it then. Make it lively, because I haven't tapped my foot or switched my hips all day, she says. Little Toni tries to explain to Grandma Dorothy that this is not from that rhythmic African sidebar of understanding where they usually pull and discuss their grandmother, granddaughter things. It's not about that, Grandma. Little Toni reminds Grandma Dorothy that what she has learned at school is not a song, but a theory. Oh, Grandma Dorothy says, well, do it, honey, do it. Grandma Dorothy says, keeping to the pattern of her African self, exclaiming, just give me a little signal when it's my turn to join in the chorus. Frustrated, little Tony announces, hands still on hips, in the true selfish, self-centered tradition of African pedagogy, modern instruction, and ultra-capitalist competitive knowledge that nobody knows the theory but her. Hand on hip still. Cynthia don't know it. Rosie don't know it. Carmen don't know it. Just I know it, she says, little Tony. This statement is made while striking an extra proud peacock color pose. It is Grandma Dorothy's response to her granddaughter's proud announcement, remembered to us by one of the most brilliant writers and activists of our time, that remains the compass whenever I need to find my way back home. Whenever I have moved too far away from something that I need to wrap myself back in as a Black woman, poet, teacher, auntie, friend, partner, lover, one who has been absolutely past the responsibility, care, and culture of the community that raised her. Madam, Grandma Dorothy tells little Tony, if your friends don't know it, then you don't know it. And if you don't know it, then you don't know nothing. Now, what else are you pretending not to know today, colored gal? What are you pretending not to know today? Soul Hot lesson number 962. What are we complicit in asking our Black girls not to know? Black girls know the answers to a wide universe of things. Ask Brianna. But nobody is asking them any questions. We live in a complicated world, and Black girls are complex beings. Nobody gives Black girls credit for being complex or for negotiating the height of those complexities. Before Bambara's essay ends, she leaps forward 30 years to surrender her Black girl woman truth to her reader. Quote, it was Grandma Dorothy who taught me critical theory, who steeped me in the tradition of Afrocentric aesthetic regulations, who trained me to understand that a story should be informed by the emancipatory impulse that characterizes our storytelling trade in these territories, as exemplified by those freedom narratives, which we have been trained to call slave narratives. Come on, Tony K. Mabron, quit it. Hip hop hips. Dr. Ruth Nicole points her girls untoward the arena. She guides them to the middle of that no Black girls allowed land where laws are made, hip hop songs are written, produced, and sacks of gold futures are handed out. Hip hop, the music, is the modern Congo Square, freedom landscape for young Black people, Black girls included. In mainstream hip hop, Black girls are considered passive, secondary, unimportant actors, relegated to the ranks of the seen but the not heard. In mainstream hip hop, the belief is, I will use your fine Black body as backdrop, but don't step center stage for any of this other. Black females are rarely credited with the knowledge of their musical culture, never included as an integral part of the stage. The Soul Hot Sanctuary, last part. What does it mean to have a sun-drenched, intimate cathedral of space created for the questions Black girls want to ask? What does it mean to have a 21st century sacred place for their 400-year-old, my mother was not my inferior and I am not inferior either attitude? What does it mean to have a shrine of a place for the way a Black girl wants to shake and move? This is not blasphemy. This is Soul Hot. This is the meeting house where the soul and the eyes of Black girls connect. This is the Black girl praise house where the heart and heel glide in. Who wrote that? This is the open door where straight girls come eye to eye with gay girls and don't always say the right or kind or politically correct thing, but learn to not look away from each other. This is a place where incense, the perfume of the ancestors, alerts Black girls that they have not entered yet another house of distorted mirrors, but a room where the eyes of others, different and similar to her own, give back a reflection of truth. Something real she can hold on to, where she, Black girl, just might appreciate and fathom another divine, good, and possible thing about herself. Soul Hot is the tradition of the old camp meeting revival where the longed-for spirit makes the journey to be fed and is fed. Soul Hot is not a religion, but Soul Hot is the ancient tradition of Black women and girls creating sacred space. Soul Hot is the voice of Ida B. Wells saying, I wish I could put my arms around my people and fly away, but instead firing up her anti-lynching campaign. Soul Hot is the voice of Fannie Lou Hamer saying, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, but then spending the rest of her life empowering Black people to rocket out of their place. Soul Hot is the shimmering voice of Barbara Jordan echoing, I will be an insurgent, at the Nixon impeachment hearings and never leaning back in her big congressional easy chair. Soul Hot is not new. Soul Hot is the revival and reconstruction of the first floor, the very foundation of Black core culture. Soul Hot is old, old promise kept, the sealing of a deal tantamount to a handshake, a Black girl pinky swear. These Black girls on the brink of womanhood are learning differently in this Soul Hot circle of intimacy and trust. Maybe their learning has begun with emphasis on the pinky bone. The pinky bone is not connected to the hand bone. The pinky bone is connected to the hand bone. The hand bone is connected to the arm bone. The arm bone is connected to the elbow bone. The elbow bone is connected to the shoulder bone. The shoulder bone is connected to the neck bone. And you know the neck bone is the most celebrated bone in the Black girl's body. Just ask her mama or her mama's mama, now strike your pose, Black girl. Pinky swear. When we reach the end of this critical book, Black Girlhood Celebration, I hope we follow Stokely Carmichael's directive from the 1960s in which he said, y'all go on home now and tell our daughters they are beautiful. 369, the goose drank wine, the monkey chewed her back on the streetcar line, the line broke, the monkey got choked, they all went to heaven in a little rowboat, clap, clap. It's a revolution going on, quietly. Nobody wants to turn and look at it in the eye, because when you look at it in the eye, you see all the things we've been doing wrong. And I'm not just talking about some people. I'm talking about even us. We have not done right in this department. And until we rethink what we've been doing, we will never get this right. But if we would just put down the control button and really understand that there is a nation of young people hurting because they feel invisible, it's time we did this. If you in any way want to get involved, see somebody, say something. Don't just sit back because, you know, there are 64,000 Black women missing in America. There are all these stories of horror stories happening to us in school systems. And we can do something about it, but we got to step up and not allow this kind of stuff to keep happening. I mean, why have a conference like this if it doesn't empower us to do something differently? And I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to feel uncomfortable when you start changing, and that's what you're supposed to feel. I was incredibly uncomfortable for about 2 minutes. And then I realized how empowering the rest of the time was. So I know we have a little bit of time for some Q&A. If you have some questions, I would love to, or Ruth Nicole can answer, or Hannah, or, you know, I don't know if anybody wants to say anything, because I'll keep singing my Black girl songs. And if somebody put on some music, I'll start dancing. No? Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming. Oh, and Melinda's going to come up. And please keep supporting. I want to say, come up, Melinda. I just want to say, 20 years ago when I got to University of Kentucky, Dr. Wilkinson was at the helm of this. And without Dr. Wilkinson insisting that this happen, this conference would not be we would not be having it today. And she's not here, and she hasn't been here for a couple of years, several years, because she's, you know, she's not well. But her spirit is here in a very strong way. So I just want us to call out her name. She started this blood, sweat, and tears with the University of Kentucky in Lexington, where there were, you know, two people in the audience, and it grows. It you know, it's like a wave thing, but it's very important that this continue. And if there's anything you can do to write a letter or something to make sure it keeps, you know, keeps going, we should think about that. And this sister here is the reason that it still goes in the way that it goes, because as long as Melinda has been here, she has also taken up the mantle, which is what we do when we're past something. And she was past this when she came in a way that has to do with her family and her mother and the tradition that she comes from. So I just want to thank you for keeping this going in the way that you have, because it matters greatly.
Yes.